A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to the crowds, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which someone has found. He hides it again, goes off happy, sells everything he owns and buys the field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he finds one of great value, he goes and sells everything he owns and buys it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet cast into the sea that brings in a haul of all kinds. When it is full, the fishermen haul it ashore. Then sitting down, they collect the good ones in a basket and throw away those that are no use. This is how it will be at the end of time. The angels will appear and separate the wicked from the just, to throw them into the blazing furnace where there will be weeping and grinding of teeth." "Have you understood all this?" They said, "Yes." And he said to them, "Well then, every scribe who becomes a disciple of the kingdom of heaven is like a householder who brings out from his storeroom things both new and old." The Gospel of the Lord. King Solomon was one of the most foolish men that ever lived. Huh? Not so? No? Who tell you that? Who tell you that? Wise? King Solomon was wise? Any man that has more than one woman can be wise. King Solomon had thousands of women. You know, right? A headache times a thousand. Eh? Like this, eh? King Solomon was actually foolish. Anybody has a Bible? I forgot my Bible upstairs, right? Anybody has a Bible? Hey, wrong church. My dear friends, the story of King Solomon is a story of really contrasting images. On one hand, Solomon is presented as a wise man. But on the other hand, Solomon is presented as a foolish man. And very often we have not recognized the foolishness of Solomon. We have not recognized how Solomon has not acted as the Lord had intended for him. And so in the Bible, which I'm still waiting on, in chapter 3 of the first book of the Kings, the first thing that they tell us is that Solomon went and took a wife from Egypt. He married a princess from Egypt. That's the first thing that they told us. And then the temple of the Lord was not yet built, neither was the palace. And Solomon was concerned about the wife he took from Egypt. What's the problem with that? I'm still waiting on the Bible. What's the problem with that? Huh? He put his wife before God. So you're not supposed to pay wife before God? Man? Yeah? You're not supposed to pay wife before God? I don't know, I don't have any wife. Tell me. Carlton, huh? No? You'll get licked when you go home. You know who's sleeping on the ground tonight. The problem was in Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 14. In Deuteronomy, the king had a specific command from the Lord. The king is not to take a wife from outside of the Israelites. And he goes and takes a wife from Egypt. But Egypt is symbolizes what? Egypt is symbolizing the place of slavery. Egypt is symbolizing the place of bondage. Egypt is symbolized as the place where God delivered the Israelites. Solomon goes back and marries a woman from Egypt, which the law said a king must not do, because every king that married outside of a woman from Israel found himself in trouble. You know why? Huh? You know why? Tell me why. Huh? A conflict of belief. What happened to King Ahab? Jezebel swayed his heart, and then he began to worship the God of Baal and not the God of Israel. What happened to Solomon? Well, Solomon wise swayed his heart and he began to worship Chimuk, he began to worship Baal, he began to worship Astarte, the god of fertility, the god of children. He began to worship all other gods, because the women who were not of Israelite stock, they swayed his heart and he began to worship their god. Hence, the law was clear. The Deuteronomic code was clear that the king of Israel must find a wife from amongst the Israelite people so that his heart will not be strayed. Because you know, women has a lot of power. You know that? Well, you know that? You know women have a lot of power. That's why priests don't get married. You know that? Huh? You don't know that? Huh? And so Solomon did what was not right. So the text will go on. I'm still waiting on the Bible. The text will go on in our first book of the Kings, chapter 3. And the text will tell us that Solomon went and worshipped on the high place, Gibeon. But that is not the place where you should worship. Where one should worship where? One should worship in Jerusalem, where the temple is.
Testing, 1, 2, 3, testing, 1, testing. Testing, 1, 2, 3. Where was I? What was I saying? Something about Solomon. Huh? That Solomon was a foolish person. I was saying something like that. Huh? Right. So, what Solomon did, he went up and he worshipped at Gibeon. You're not supposed to do that. And the text tells us that he went and worshipped at Gibeon, where the place of worship is Jerusalem, where the Ark of the Covenant was. Remember his father David brought the Ark of the Covenant down to Jerusalem, and David wanted to build a temple for the Lord in 2 Samuel 7:7-14. And the Lord said, no, not you, but your son Solomon is the one who is going to build me a temple. So Solomon's mandate wasn't to take woman from Egypt. What Solomon's mandate was to build a temple for the Lord first. That was Solomon's mandate. And Solomon, unfortunately, didn't do what he's supposed to do. What we meet here in the text
is now another tradition. So the text said Solomon loved the Lord. So there was no question. And then, so Solomon loved the Lord. Solomon goes to pray, and the Lord says to Solomon, Solomon, ask me anything you want, and I will give it to you. And the text says that Solomon asked for wisdom. Solomon asked for wisdom, and wisdom was given unto him, like no other human being had. But that wisdom was given to him for governance, and to know what is right from wrong. And because of that, the Lord blessed Solomon. Why? Because here Solomon is choosing God first. He's choosing God first. He's putting God first in asking for wisdom. But the problem with Solomon is, though he's choosing God first, he's not choosing God with his whole heart. That's Solomon's problem. The text tells us Solomon loved God. And all of us love God enough. But what's the problem? What's the problem that God looked at Solomon in such a way? The problem was that Solomon did not love God with all his heart. Deuteronomy chapter 6. The Deuteronomy writers, they said, Hear, O Israel, the Shema, the Lord your God is one God, and you will love the Lord with all your heart, with all your strength. One to the Deuteronomy code says that we are called to love the Lord with all our hearts. Solomon loved the Lord, but not with all his heart. He loved the Lord, but not with all his heart. And the problem very often that all of us have to contend with is our ego. Because most people love the Lord. Most people are good people. Most people are striving to do what is good and what is right and what is just. Most people seek after the things of the Lord. But the problem is, not many people love the Lord with all their heart. Not many people love the Lord with all their heart. And therein lies Solomon's demise. And I say demise because that is what it was. And so the Lord showed that if you choose me first, that's the wisdom that God wants us to understand. That's the wisdom that God wants us to understand. The wisdom that God wants us to understand in our age and in our time is that choosing me first, putting me first, but putting me first with all your heart. With all your heart. If you put me first with all your heart, then everything else will be added on. Solomon's problem was that Solomon did not do that consistently. And if you go back, when you go home, you still have a Bible home? You can find it because nobody can find it in the church. So if you can't find a Bible in the church, I doubt you will find it home. Go back and read the book of the Kings. 1 Kings chapter 3. Read the book of the Kings. I want to read the text for you. From chapter 2. Solomon entered into a marriage alliance with Pharaoh, king of Egypt. He took Pharaoh's daughter and brought her to the city of David until he had finished building his own palace, Yahweh's house, and the wall around Jerusalem. Meantime, the people were sacrificing at the high places because the house of the name had not yet been built. This is why Solomon also sacrificed burnt incense at the high place. And although he loved Yahweh and followed the commands of his father David, although Solomon loved Yahweh and followed the commands of his father David, he worshipped at the high place. His heart was divided. Solomon's demise and foolishness was a divided heart. A divided heart. And it is under Solomon that the Israelite kingdom will be divided. It is under Solomon, because of Solomon's divided heart, because of Solomon not loving the Lord with all his heart, with all his might, and with all his strength, the kingdom was divided because he went and worshipped other gods. And that's a no-no. The king had very strict rules.
This is the year of the word of the Lord, and the church still doing that? I'm just asking, I don't know. I'm just asking.
Deuteronomy chapter 17 from verse 14. When you come to the land which Yahweh your God gives you, and when you have conquered it and lived in it, you shall perhaps say, I would like to have a king like the neighboring nations. You have to appoint a king chosen by Yahweh from among your brothers. You shall not appoint a foreign king who is not the brother of the Israelites. Verse 16. Ensure that your king does not acquire many horses, lest he again send his people to Egypt to get more horses. For the Yahweh commanded you never to go back that way. What did Solomon do? He went back that way. And I heard the Egyptian women were sweet. The Egyptian princesses were sweet. Poor Solomon. Huh? When he saw the princess, his knees started to shake. You must not go back that way. But in his own weakness, Solomon went back that way. The text isn't finished. Neither shall you have many women, lest they pervert his heart. This is a direct command to the king. How many women Solomon had? Plenty. Too many to count. And neither let him pile up gold and silver. When he sits on his royal throne, he must make a copy of his law on the scroll given to him by the Levitical priest. He shall bring it with him and read it every day of his life, and he may learn to fear Yahweh, keeping all his sayings of the law and putting his precepts into practice. So let him not become conceited nor look down on his brothers, nor turn aside from the commandments, neither to the right nor to the left, so that he and his children may lengthen the days of their reign in the midst of Israel. The length of their reign wasn't lengthened, because Jeroboam and Rehoboam both separated. One went to the north, one went to the south, and the Davidic kingdom was divided under Solomon. Because Solomon was not wise enough. Solomon did not act wisely enough. The true wisdom of God is seeking first the kingdom of heaven and his righteousness. Jesus will now come, because Jesus says in the gospel, the Queen of Sheba came from all the ends of the world to hear the wisdom of Solomon. Well, here is something greater than Solomon here. And what is greater than Solomon? Who is greater than Solomon? Was Jesus. And Jesus' wisdom said, seek first the kingdom of heaven and all and its righteousness, and all other things shall be added. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. That seeking first the kingdom of heaven is the wisdom. That's the wisdom that we must hold. The wisdom that we must have. Proverbs chapter 3 will then tell us that when you seek wisdom, when you find wisdom, then God will give you riches, then God will give you wealth, then God will give you all other things. But seeking first the kingdom of heaven, that is the heart of the wisdom that we are invited to have. That's the wisdom of Christ. It's the partial wisdom of Solomon. He didn't follow through on it because he had a divided heart. We cannot serve God with a divided heart, because God is a jealous lover. God is a jealous lover. He's an insecure lover. He wants you totally, completely, and only. And if we are not able to give him ourselves totally, completely, and only, then he's not interested in us. That's the demand of God. That's the demand of God. The demand is all or nothing. The demand is all or nothing. This weekend we celebrate the feast of Joachim and Anne, the patron of marriage. Joachim and Anne the grandparents of Jesus, and they represent for us the patrons of marriage, to whom we ask the intercession for all married couples. And tomorrow, please God, we'll have the renewal of married vows. But the wisdom of marriage is similar.
You can't love and enter into marriage with a divided heart. A marriage is not something with three persons. I remember Princess Diana said, from the beginning there were three of us. From the beginning there were three of us. It could never work. Not me, I did. Princess Diana said that in the interview, the documentary. It will never work. It will never work. If you enter into it with a divided heart, it will never work. And that's the wisdom of marriage. That one must come to give oneself completely, totally over to the other. Completely and totally over to the other. Your eye can be longer than your belly, you know. You know some people eye longer than their belly? And you see, they're eating with the eyes more than they're eating with the belly. You can't be greedy. You can't be greedy. Be contented with what you have. Be contented with the blessing that God has given to you. And recognize that this commitment that you have made is a commitment to give your whole heart. I am often amazed when I listen to couples professing them vows. I profess my vows to God, and God, I only have to say about me, because God is faithful to 1,000 generations. God will leave in me. I might take a leave God, God forbid. God will leave in me. Carlton, you remember? I, Carlton Sinclair, promise to honor you, Alicia. In riches and in, for better for worse, in sickness and in health. For riches and for poverty. My God, is an unconditional vow you are making to another human being before God. You're making that vow before God. It's an unconditional vow to love and to cherish this one person. This one person. To love and to cherish this one person for all eternity. Olive Reed. On a real way. Human beings are coming up. Human beings are change. It's change quick. Especially when the situation changes. But marriage is a sacrament. Why? Because marriage is supposed to represent the ways in which God's love, just as God has his great love, Christ has his great love for the church, a love that does not change, a love that sacrifices itself, a love that loves wholeheartedly, a love that loves with an undivided heart, a love that gives itself to the end. That's the love that Christ has for the church, and marriage in one sense must image that love. Hence it is called a sacrament. It's supposed to symbolize that. And if you are ready for that, then don't go in the people thing. Don't interfere with the people thing, because that is a serious thing. On the day of judgment, the Lord will ask you about the vows you took in front of this altar here, before the Lord. Because marriage is a sacrament that the couples exchange. The priest and the best man and the chief bridesmaid, we are merely witnesses to the vows that you profess to one another before Almighty God. And hence the reason Father Jason is very particular when it comes to marriages. Hence the reason I say, let's take our time. Let's take a journey. Let's make sure this is who you want and what you want. Let's not rush into anything. Because when you get tied up in Catholic vows, you can't get out of it. Catholic vows is tied up in it. You can't get out that easily. Then we get annulment and all kind of things, because we don't believe in divorce. So Catholic vows are serious vows. You don't rush into Catholic vows. Because we take it seriously. And on the day of judgment, God is going to ask you, were you married then? You know they were going to last?
And you know, the man was calling me the girl all the time, why am I marrying him? Huh? The Lord is going to ask me that. So I, in my goodness, you see how I black already? I can't take no more fire. But I know blacker to get. So I will not be doing those marriages. Unfortunately, you can find another priest, you can find another deacon. Do not come to me. Because I have to be of sound mind to be able to act on behalf of the church and to be act and to act on behalf of the state to say that these couples who are professing their vows intend to keep their vows. Remember, I was at the marriage and I had some inside information because the person who was getting married was my friend. And he had a relationship with a girl who sang the marriage song. Well, I couldn't say anything. I was not a priest yet. I couldn't say anything. The girl was singing the marriage song. That was the foreigner woman, you know. At the man. But Tom, go on, I'm a priest, young boy. We may be laughing, but this is a serious thing. It's a serious thing. And so we come back to the wisdom of Solomon. The wisdom of Solomon is that unless we are willing to love God with an undivided heart, totally and completely, then we are not ready. We are not ready to become disciples of Christ. At the same time, our love for God must represent our love for one another. And if you have taken vows to love another person, or you intend to take vows to love another person, make sure that you intend to do so wholeheartedly. And make sure you intend to love this person and this person alone. No third wheel. And that's the wisdom of Solomon. That's the wisdom of Jesus, and that's the wisdom of God. Anything else is foolishness.